Let's go. I want to dive in game, guys. I was ready for us to go in game already, and now I'm like, we're not in game, and I'm like, I gotta find more things to say, and I just wasn't ready to find more things to say, you know? Like, I'm ready to start. Oh, the stage is flashing. This is it, guys. If the stage is flashing, we must be getting ready to go. This has gotta be it this time. We're gonna go in game. Yes, we are. Welcome to Serral vs. Maru maps 7 and 8 of the WTL vs. the World event. In the bottom left-hand corner, the red Zerg player is gonna be Serral. It's 3-3 in this series, so these two maps either go 1-1 and we get an ace match best of one, or it goes 2-0 either side and they will win the series for their team. Maru in the top right-hand side of the map, our blue Terran player. A little bit of info first of all, welcome if you're watching on YouTube. If you enjoy the video, if you like it, give it a thumbs up, like it, and maybe subscribe to the channel. Helps us out a whole bunch. I just got to say apologies that there's no game sound for this video. We've got StarCraft music running in the background, but no game sound because there is no... we're casting off the Chinese feed, so they don't have a... We don't have a clean feed. If we were to put the sound on, you guys would hear the Chinese commentators, and I just can't personally focus with the Chinese commentators in my ears. So, hence we are obviously instead just going to be having this without game sound. That's just the way it works. It was this, so we don't cast the event at all, basically, so... That's the situation. Obviously a bit unfortunate, but we just gotta do what we gotta do. Sometimes it be like that. Let's just enjoy the great games of StarCraft 2 anyways, and not let the lack of game sound take it away from us as we kick this off, this two-game series between two titans of the scene. And honestly, you know, the few times we saw Maru versus Serral, because, you know, when they were both winning everything that year, right? Everyone was like, we want to see them, we want to see them. We never saw them. And then in the past year, kind of the past year or so, we've seen them play a few times, and to be honest, I feel like a lot of the time it was never like, oh yes, Maru is looking amazing right now, and Serral's looking amazing. Like, they both always look amazing, right? But they're not in, like, winning everything sort of mode. And while that's still not true, I do feel like this is probably the best form of Maru we've seen in a long time, and the best form of Serral we've been seeing in a long time. So now when they're starting to meet again, I get a bit more excited. This is a massive matchup, obviously an overall best of 9. These guys just play 2 maps of it. If you're watching this on YouTube, you probably saw the previous 2 uploads as well. If not, you can either check the description down below or just check the channel. There'll be the last 2 uploads before this one, I believe, is my plan on how I'm going to upload it. But it's a big matchup. This is actually a $12,500 best of 9. Yes, it's a big matchup, just a straight-up $12,500 show match. It's $7,500 or about $8,000 to the winners and about $4,500 to the losing team. So each player just gets $1,200 basically for showing up, even if their team loses, never mind if they win. So it's a pretty good payday. Show up, play a couple maps, get paid over $1,000 more if you win. I'm just going to be seeing our Reaper initially, having a little bit of a move around here to try and see what's going on. We start on Glitter and Ashes, I think a little unfortunate for Maru because obviously our first map here is just generated randomly. It's the second map that will be the loser picks, though. So if you do lose the first game, you do then have your map preference for the second game, potentially giving us a better chance of obviously seeing, you know, the 1-1 scoreline happen and maybe for us to take it to that ace game. So definitely a bit of potential there as the Reaper hops up into the main base and is going to run around the back. Going to try and go for some of these drones. Going to bop those up in the sky. The Queen taking some damage as well. Viking on the way out here early from Maru. Serral's having that fast Rotor on also coming up, though. So what are we going to do, Serral? We're going to have the gas for about 6 roaches initially. Like I say, it's pretty quick, and Maru's just going to go for a fusion core. I was wondering, Glitter and Ashes, if he might just play some mech, and going for the BC opener definitely is fairly suggestive of that, as Lings are going to be drawn into the Hellion fires. The Hellion show up to defend that Reaper in the middle of the map. And Serral just having his first roach starting. Lair on the way. Extra links coming up. Well, quick Lair is obviously the right call here as well for Serral. If he's playing faster Evo Chambers, the BC is more likely to be an issue for longer. With the fast Lair, you can get into the Spire quickly, and the faster your Spire is, the faster you get Corruptors, the sooner you really start to deal with this opening of Maru, and the sooner you start to shut that down, the better, basically, at this stage. The Viking continues to ping onto this Overlord. It's going to go down, so Overlord will fall. Just seeing the two Hellions and the Reaper continuing back up to the top. And just going to return home for the moment. Five Ovies on the way from Serral, so he's really trying to get unsupply blocked here at the moment. He's been a little bit caught up and maybe not the perfect opening thus far. Here come the few roaches heading across the map. The Viking has seen it, so a little bit of pressure from these roaches. It's interesting, there's not a lot to deal with this outside of the Hellions, but the Hellions are actually in decent numbers. They can probably do okay here. The Viking will help as well. What I was thinking is, we actually saw yesterday when we were casting some BC openings, was that I think it was Solar hit some roaches around the left side, and the moment the BC teleports across the map, then the roaches run at the natural and they can do very well, because obviously the, you know, the main point of defense is gone. And Serral sets up a Spire and a Baneling Nest. It is going to be Stim behind this, and Maru is going to play just one BC into Bio. So Maru Battlecruiser into Bio play here. Momentarily started a Raven. Looks like that was cancelled quickly. As here comes that BC showing up. No Sporecrawler ready. Serral going to have to collect the Queens up. There's no creep between the natural and the main either, though. So you're going to have slow-moving Queens there. Oh, this Queen didn't really know where to go to. He ran it left, then he ran it right. So it kind of moved around, derped around a little bit for just a few moments. Now this BC goes from the main base, he's forced to evacuate of all workers, to the third, which will also have to evacuate. Maru doing some serious damage here early on. The Battlecruiser is doing absolute wonders. It's going to be seeing the Battlecruiser going to go and get a couple more of these drones. He's doing wonderful damage with this. Serral's actually just straight up dying to the BC opening at the moment. This is not good at all, from the roaches not doing much to all the rest of it. Serral's already kind of smiling a little bit to himself, knowing that this is not going well, and he's going to have to play from behind. Well, the problem is, when you take damage like this, if it was mech, he might be okay, because you'll have time to recover before the first attack really gets set up to a powerful point. But when you're playing Bio, the first attack of the Terran, 1-1's already halfway done, Stim is done, you're not going to have a lot here. As Serral, when this first attack shows up, the BC teleports home, so it's going to get repaired. The mutas are not going to be able to catch that for a freebie kill. I'm just going to see the few SCVs repairing up that BC at the moment. So working on that at the moment and working on through, just going to be seeing our Hellions morphing into Hellbats up on the top side. Just coming up, there is a missile turret there to turn those mutas around. Mutas are going to start making their way to the natural. Problem is, the mutas are not in position to help deal with this attack. And while mutas are not the best straight-up fighting units, I'm not sure how much Serral really has to straight-up fight at all right now. I mean, Banes don't have Baneling speed. Mutas are collecting back up over here to maybe try and help this. The fourth base is already in a lot of trouble, though. Amari is looking to be in a fantastic spot here in map number one. The mutas are going to fly in overhead, going to look to clean out whatever they can. Trying to jump on this, he is going to get a cleanup. He's now going to start chasing down the medevacs. Deems it not worthwhile to chase through the battlecruiser fire, though. Turns it around, the medevacs survive, and Maru continues to dominate this game. 1-1 to 0-0. Baneland still morphing, but missing upgrades. And Maru just cleaning out creep, taking away all map control from Serral here and looking to get a 1-0 lead. Kind of just plain and simple, not much else to say about it. Not much complicated to kind of add on here at all. Drilling Claws coming up, the Thor on the way out still. The Marines and the Battlecruiser still coming through. A few of these Lings still being picked away at as well. The mutas are overhead and just trying to help out wherever they can. Overlord farm, though. Uh-oh. There's going to be a few Ovies going down before Serral responds. Massive supply block for him. Good news is you're going to lose some units. You get unsupply block. The Lings are going to block, and the Marines are going to get caught by the Banelings. Decent fight for Serral, all things considered. We will run after the medevacs again, catch those. The BC looks as though... Does it have a teleport still? Yes, it does, but it doesn't matter. Teleported too late. BC goes down, and Serral gets something of a cleanup here, so... Game will go on, and the muta's actually chasing for a few more Marines as well. They try and target a muta down to just get some extra final bits of value out of that, but just not going to be enough. And Serral is able to continue across the map with the mutas to try and play himself back into this game. It's not pretty, it's not looking good, but, well, it's better than it was, a minute ago. He's cleaned up a few attacks, he's had a couple of decent trades. Like I say, better than it was a few moments ago. Serral somewhat improving his position here. Still doesn't exactly feel great, don't get me wrong, but like I say, better than nothing. We do have our missile turrets obviously coming up across the board, a lot of them. Mario's really going like overboard on the Muta defense, because he knows he's in a good position if he can also just keep the Mutas back. And at a point here, he's probably going to want to try and take advantage of that position. But you can't really take advantage of it if you're permanently kept at home due to the Mutas. So over defending the Mutas at home so he can move out somewhat safely. And then he can actually force some more fights, which is what he wants to do with the upgrade lead and all the rest of it. So that's Mario's plan. And he is coming once again around this left side. Focus on the fourth base, of course. Deny that, and Sarah will be in a bit more trouble. That wooden line just goes off on the left-hand side. Gets a decent clump of Ling Bane when it goes off here. As here we go, just flying through. The Thor's going to do a lot of tanking here. It's going to get a lot of damage on the Mutas, and it's not even a competition. Mario just has way too much. Too good of an early game. And he is now going to take that 1-0 lead. And for the first time today, Team WTL are going to take the lead of this best of nine. My assumption, my guess would be this is probably going to be... Oh, wow, Hardwire going to be the pick. Okay. I was going to say maybe Pride, but he's actually going to pick Hardwire. All right, well, let's kick this off. Let's get this going. No Pride of Altaris. I wonder if they remove Pride from the map pool. I wonder if they're like, hey, we just don't want the Zergs picking Pride for the free wins. All right, kicking this off and getting this underway. Serral is in the top right-hand corner. Needs to win this to keep Team World in the best of nine. Maru in the bottom left, if he wins this, wins it for WTL. Let's see what happens. I have everyone in the chat saying about how Serral's about to pick Pride of Altaris and how that's going to be busted and how crazy it's going to be. And I'm just here like, well, I would have joined in. I would have said the exact same, but Hardwire it is. It's actually kind of surprising. Like I said, I wonder if there is something that they've... I don't know if they would have changed anything. I don't know. Anyways, important thing is it is Hardwire. Still one of the usual Zerg map picks, right? When you get into like a best of five, a Zerg will pick Glittering, and then Hardwire usually, because obviously the Pride of Altaris will be vetoed. It's going to be seen on Overworld coming across. One of the interesting things about Pride, right, and this is something which I do think is a factor sometimes, and why Zergs don't always pick it, is they don't get a lot of practice on Pride and ZVT, right? Because, well, when do they ever get to play it? When the Terrans veto it all the time. So maybe you just feel much more comfortable on Hardwire. You don't want to leave that gold base kind of up to chance or anything along those lines. I think those are all things you sometimes want to be a little careful of. There's going to be seen two queens on the way out. Reaper is heading across the map, so moving up to the top right-hand side. It's going to be seeing the extra lings and the queens all coming in at the moment here as we get this up and rolling. So a little bit of setup from Sarah, a little bit of setup from Maru. Waiting to see if he's going to drop down a second gas. Looks like he probably will not. It's just going to be a third CC from our Terran player in the near future. Just macro-focused opening once again. More of what we know and love. There is that third CC coming in. And just, like I say, Mary not going to look to do anything too crazy early game. Is just happy to set up into that macro focus, set up into the macro game, and just play from there. Maybe it continues up and just hops into the main base, and we'll just guy grenade down. Queen was already moving over here, so he's able to deflect the Reaper. It actually takes quite a lot of hits, but obviously deflected, not in the base. That's the most important thing. You're denying the scout for a little while. Any information you can deny can be nice. You know, just take any kind of thoughts of what Maru might want to get up to away from him, or, you know, maybe kind of keep some fear in him. It's like, hey, look, maybe this is a, this has the potential, the possibility to be like a roach roar and you don't know about it, right? So, Maru maybe has to play a bit more scared around that as we go Viking on the opening. A couple Hellions on the way out as we take the additional gas on the, I believe, third base as well. So we're up to three gas already, he has Maru. Like I said, just Hellion Viking at the moment. I was going to say, I feel like with three grass, he's probably going to go Fusion Core here as well. So, Fusion Core going to be our setup as we get that up and running. Let me get this underway. Marina Viking just going to clean out this Overlord, which is just trying for a bit of a scout, so we'll not get far enough in to realize that this is going to be a Fusion Core opening again. So, Maru continuing to open with these Battlecruisers. I wonder if he does just go for one BC into Bio again, or if this becomes maybe something a little different. There's our first BC coming up. He already started Stim before the BC started, so yes, it is going to be Bio on the back of this. Just that one BC to get us going initially. And to be fair, last time Seraph's preparation for Battlecruiser was not the best, to say the least. That's not ideal as our Spore gets up and running. Just going to be seeing the creep continue to push around the top side. Alien's coming through. Guys, I'm just going to take one very quick second to see what the puppy wants. Apologies, she had her ball stuck under my shelf and was crying for it. I just didn't want to have her continuing to whimper and bark in the background of the game. So Spire on the natural expansion, just going to see the Hellions coming through. Just going to get a creep tumor kill. I'm just going to have a couple of extra racks coming up as our BC teleports into the upper right side of the map. Going to get in on top of this base, but four queens and a spore crawler here means a lot of damage output pretty much immediately onto that battle cruiser. And that means it gets four drones, but that will be about it. The BC will not really do too much else or have too much of a role to play for the moment. We'll probably just sit back there until it can teleport home, get repaired, and into the next step. I mean, if it gets the chance to. Spire is coming up. Sarah looking as though he's going to end up playing Mutas again here. Mutas are nice when you've got that BC up because it is something that can help to just push that BC away a little bit more reliably as the Hellions work their way around the left-hand side. That BC comes into the back of the natural. A couple of drones already being shot down. Sporecrawler and a queen just onto that battlecruiser once again. So a couple of drones going down. Armory still coming up, 1-1 upgrades and combat shields still coming up. All of that still coming through as our Marines are going to go and chase down an Overseer. Overseer is going to get popped and that will be taken down as we get the Mutalisks continuing through. Evolution Chambers coming into play and just going to be having Serral starting to think about his future in terms of upgrades, etc. Well, that's all good news. See our medevac moving out to the center as well. Yeah, I mean, obviously right now it's about the Mutas and then you'll be playing this upgrade deficit as Serral, but you've got the Mutas to try and harass around and upgrades maybe will not be as important as you want them to be. BC teleports home. Now, with the right amount of SCVs repairing, I don't think that should be a threat at all. You know, BC obviously can't teleport any longer, but with SCVs repairing, the BC should be able to just stay alive. That's the one thing I was just thinking of. Can the Mutas get the BC kill here somehow because it's teleports on cooldown? I think the answer is just no. BC will be used as part of the anti-Muta defense. Gets rid of one Muta right away as they kill off a refinery, just trying to slow the gas income of Maru and trying to throw his build off that little bit at the moment. Marines and Hellbats still continuing up, just up that right-hand side. A couple of Banelings in some trouble as well, and we do have Mary's push. Arriving just before Serral had a lot of those Banes ready, but they do get finished before the engagement has to happen, and, well, only issue for Serral is he's still working behind a set of upgrades at the moment, so also a factor here as that CC comes into the front. Overlord spread out across the left side. Yeah, obviously just more Ling Bane Muta, so we'll see if Serral can make the Ling Bane Muta work out as these few Marines on this side actually getting picked off. Doesn't get the lift back on the medevac. Here comes the BC, is flown back across the map. Should have a teleport available so that you can go home for free and you don't lose the BC. So it's basically just a few free drone kills And that means that that's obviously just good news, right? You get, you know, drone kills for free. You always take those. You don't say no to freebies. Mario just heading into Drilling Claws is going to be playing that mind-focused game from this point onwards. We have got the Infestation Pit already coming up. The Mutas all diving down to the bottom side of the map. 9 more drones coming through. The Baneland still in production, plus 2 flyer attack and the 1-1 upgrades. All continuing into action here. I mean, 1-1 will help Cyril out a lot if he can take some fights with that. He wants to dive and get that single siege tank. That's one of the only siege tanks. It costs him a couple of meters, though, so definitely doesn't come for free. And it's a little bit of a shame to be losing out on that. It's going to be seeing Cyril's army collecting over to that right-hand side. Mario's going to get a little bit of a read on that as he sees a couple of those banelings rolling over in that direction. Cyril also has the counterattack set up on the left-hand side, so he's got attacks coming in a couple different directions. Excited to see what that means in the next few moments. Banes bust through that first set of depots and opening up the space. 5 SCVs going down, but that's about it. Widowmine's helping in the corner there. The Mutas are going to show up, and they're going to clean out the Widowmines, which is a good start to this. The Widowmine shot on the right side doesn't do much. Yeah, not much else to be done. I was expecting more from this, I suppose, just on the fact that the army on the right side is there's still a little bit over there, so maybe that can roll in and do something, but was yet to make a move still. Now we see these Lings running on forward, and the CC going to get cancelled up. The Sense Tower in trouble. Oh, SCVs get blown up. And so does the Planetary Fortress. So Mario losing out on the 6 o'clock. We'll instantly just replace that in position. So no CC nearby to replace. Has to be something he replaces manually here. As we do have the Force of Mario moving back up into the middle of the map. A lot of Lings and a lot of Banes on the way out right now. We've got 15 more Banelings joining up as well as Cyril. It's an important fight for him to push back because he just did good damage to Mario. So if he can push back this attack, you really do end up in a pretty strong position overall. These few Banes actually do get through and they find themselves a Widow Mine. So the more of those you deny, the better it's typically going to turn out for you as well. All factors to consider here. Running back around, a few Marines show up. The Lings get pushed back on the left side. The Lings are going to show up as well. Running straight into this mineral line looking for some SCVs. Obviously only an orbital over here. The wall off is open. The Widow Mines have been cleaned out from the previous attack. And that's where Cyril will start to do damage. He does respect that army of Mario, though, and would rather keep these Lings alive for a later attack than keep them there and try and kill off a few more SCVs, which he probably could have done. He believes the later game attack would just be better for him as he splits the Mutas off to go around the side, avoid the Marines, get some medevacs. Feels like Cyril's really controlling a lot of these fights. That CC has just now finished up. We'll lift to the sky straight away. 4 Thors here, and that's going to be a big factor. That's a very tanky set of units, and it means the Mutas cannot do a lot when in range of those. They need to be very cautious because they will melt if that Thor fire comes through. These SCVs all stacked, though. Mario doesn't realize it. Fresh mules as well. Mineral line gets blown on up. And Cyril is looking to give us an ace match here. Mario will scan, noticing the couple of burrowed Banes on the back end of that. That's impressive, but obviously already having lost a good chunk of SCVs. Cyril just continues through with more Ultra Cavern coming down here. I know we like to complain about Ultras, but in a game like this where momentum is on your side, Ultras are the next natural step to just keep on these trades, right? You're already trading well. If you can bring the Ultras out and keep those trades going, like I say, that only benefits you. Oh, what the mines here do go off, though, and the Mutas take a bit of a clipping, so now they need to be careful, and Mutas back away, and that's going to be nice for the first time. Mario maybe has a little bit of breathing room, first time in a while. As the Mutas aren't going to be flying around his bases, the Ling Bane is held off by some rocks at the moment. Just continue to kill off the rocks, clean that out, and then we can have an easier attack path through as Cyril is just going to start diving in on this base. No respect, just going to go straight into this. I mean, the Thors are quite far back, so the Mutas can come in, help against the siege tank SCVs. Try and run away from this. The Banes are going to roll up the ramp. There's nothing even really for them to kill here. Going for bio units and then kind of connecting on the Thors after. The Lings are going to get through to the Thors, and I think that's a big deal. If you can clean some Thors out, the Mutas are just going to continue to be that little bit better. Probably does have a bit of an impact as well. GG from Mario. Cyril gets the map win, keeps Team World in it, and is going to give us an ace match in WTL versus the world. We will get a map 9. And I think that's all we could have asked for, guys. A map 9 going to be coming up here in Cyril versus Maru. Well, actually, I mean, maybe not Cyril versus Maru, but WTL versus the world. But Cyril Maru gives us our 9th map. Let's get that ready to go. Oh, another screen. Oh, this is not what I wanted. I wanted Rogue and Cyril action, and I want it now. Oh, there we go. Top right-hand side, then, for Team World. It is going to be Cyril. And the bottom left-hand side, our blue Zerg player is going to be Rogue. Alrighty, guys, here we are. That's kind of what we got to have. An ace match, right, I think is all I really wanted to get out of this. As long as we had an ace match, I was coming out of this pretty happy. I was in a pretty good place. So I'm excited we've got ourselves an ace match here. Hopefully you guys are excited for the games as well. I think this should be a fantastic ending to what's been a pretty fun series. Rogue has indeed 12 pooled, so let's believe in not the drone pool, though. We're going to send one drone ahead of everything else. Uh-oh. That means potentially an early spy. He's actually going to patrol. Oh, he's going to build a hatchery over here. So he's going to try and fake out Cyril a little bit. I see. Well, this is going to be a regular 12 pool then. That means it shouldn't be too bad for Cyril. Obviously, a regular 12 pool like this should not be problematic. The problem is if he sees the natural being empty and the third base is obviously up and running, then you are maybe going to react in the wrong way as Cyril, and that could be much more problematic for him, actually. So that could be an issue. Things are going to show up. Obviously, for now, this is a pretty regular 12 pool focused defense here. As you can see, those links starting to nibble on that hatchery, so nibbling it up, getting this underway. I'm just going to be seeing Cyril. Cyril, he sees no hatchery, man. He's going to start a spine, he's going to let the natural expansion probably die. Okay, he does pull drones. Like I say, he's starting the spine, though, as though he's expecting this, like I say, to be a gas follow-up, but now he is going to start fighting this. As links come down, the drones will fight this with. Cyril loses two workers here. Cyril loses the Ling fight as well. He needs to buy time for the Queen to get out. That would be the ideal situation. If you can get the Queen out, then that will help him a lot. As the Lings are going to dive for the hatchery. They're going to go for it with the drone pull. Cyril is going to defend the hatch. Low HP, but alive. Well, that's something. Could be worse. That's going to be seeing the Overlord there, going to get shoved away, is going to get taken down, so Overlord drops off, and let's see what happens. I mean, Cyril, coming out of a supply block, is down by 6 workers, going to drop a Bane Nest of his own. He's only building Lings right now, guys. I think Cyril is just going to completely commit to this. He's just going to send it. Huh? Just going to Ling Flood, Ling Bane attack across the map, and just all in himself on the back of this attack, so setting up for it. Let's see how it goes. Link speed starts from Rogue, nowhere near getting a Baneling Nest just yet. As Cyril stacking up the Lings. He's got a few Lings on the left-hand side as well, which is important because that means he can morph in the Banelings across the map already, right? That's definitely a factor. That's definitely an important part of this. I like that Cyril's being aggressive because to me, I think that aggression signals as well that he's going to be able to defend his hatchery, because obviously this is a situation where his hatchery is very low HP, so by taking the initiative, he can minimize the chance of Rogue taking advantage of that. There go those Banelings. Like we've been talking about, Bane Nest not ready from Rogue. He is making these Lings, have seen what's up. He is making Lings of his own, but he will not have Ling speed, so he'll not be able to fight very easily. And at the same time, we are going to start seeing those Queens able to chase down another Overlord, right? I mean, a supply block here could be deadly. First Banelings get targeted down. All three of them go down. They do not do anything at all. Extra Banes coming in from Cyril. Full wall off here on this hatchery. As Cyril is going to have extra Banelings trying to finish up. He does not have that one cancelled. He's going to get to finish it. But the wall off is really good. And these drones, okay, now you're going to slip into this mineral line. A drone gets taken down by Banelings there. The Queens are now surrounded. There are still a couple of Banelings from Cyril. Rogue is making spine crawlers. One in this third base, one elsewhere. I guess over towards the main base. Obviously, the natural expansion is not up and running in this situation. 9 drones of Rogue going down. Several's done good damage so far, and he will take some Ling Bane up into the main. He can finish the spine on this low ground too. I don't think that's an issue. I think it's actually worth doing because it keeps the space open for attack later. And Serral actually does get chased away from the main though. He deals with the Baneling down here. He's trying to get this hatchery at this stage. We continue Ling Bane production. Serral has a way more supply. It's all about, okay, he's going to grab a queen as well. It's kind of about the Banelings at this point and how well these Banelings can trade. Can these Banelings get good connections or not? Serral sending Lings forward to trade with the Banelings. He's going to have a Baneling of his own still left over. New Banes of Rogue about to finish up, and Serral will just not cancel one. So he is going to lose a few Lings to that as it finishes and moves around a little bit. Well, I'm just going to be seeing Lings running up into the main base. He's got one more Baneling trying to make the main mineral line. He's going to get to the drones. Oh, he hits the spine. He doesn't quite reach the drones with it. But a Chaos and the Ling Bane continuing through as Serral still on the army supply lead. He's obviously killed the queens of his opponent, so Rogue is missing injects, Rogue is missing drones. And Serral showing he's got a bit of, you know, feistiness in his own ZVZ. He's sick of Rogue being the feisty, aggressive player that gets to do everything he wants day in and day out in this matchup. No, not fair. Rogue doesn't have enough. And Serral will take it for Team World. And that is your ace match. That is your champion of this little show match here. Big show match, big prize money, $8,000 to the winning team. Congratulations, Serral, Raynor, Showtime, and Hero Marine. Team World looked good today, guys. I mean, Hero Marine looked like he could have won the maps against Rogue earlier as well, that's for sure. So, yeah, kind of a wild day. To wrap up WTL vs. The World, Serral gets it done against Rogue on the counterattack.